He had brilliance.
He could play so many instruments, and he gave the Stones an extra level of creativity, live on stage and also in the studio. But like so many others, he spiraled downhill. His father believes it was losing Anita to Keith that propelled him, as the Let It Bleed sessions were taking place. Brian Jones showed his signs of deterioration and lack of motivation. His coordination between his right and left hand was off. His rhythm was all over the place, and that's sort of a side effect of drugs, as it did take him over. There was a time when Brian visited Jimi Hendrix in the studio. You can hear him enter and attempt to play piano with Jimmy and the others in the session. Jimmy, basically, as he was talking to Eddie Kramer, the engineer, saying, no, 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 get him out. In November of 1968, Brian bought Cotchford Farms, an estate once owned by the Winnie the Pooh author, A.A. Milne, located in East Sussex. On a warm July 2nd, 1969, despite all the rumors that Brian was having a wild party at his house and filled with people, Brian was with his new girlfriend, 22-year-old Swedish model Anna Wollen. He had stopped seeing his prior steady girlfriend in April, Suki Portier. He was also with his handyman, his helper around the house, Frank Thorogood, along with a nurse named Janet Lawson. He worked in his music room for a bit, had dinner with all at approximately around 8:30 p.m. He watched Laughing on TV, and sometime around 9:30, 10:30, he decided to go for a swim. Within the hour, he was found lying at the bottom of the pool. So many stories and conspiracies that he was arguing and horsing around with Frank by the pool. It was known that Brian owed money to Frank and other workers, and that was concerning. Brian was announced dead a few hours later, and Frank Thorogood admitted on his deathbed to only one person, though, that he killed Brian. So it's still undetermined and not 100% clarified. Since then, a new owner remodeled that pool and very creepy sold the original pool tiles to fans for £150 each.
Let's face it, the future as a Rolling Stone is very uncertain.
This documentary is not about Brian, but about what I consider to be the best and my favorite Rolling Stones album, Let It Bleed. Many would agree and many would disagree. Many would agree that it is perfect and why it proves the Stones are the world's greatest rock and roll band. I will attempt to provide you an insight to this time period, before, during, and after these sessions. I want you to walk away with better knowledge and why I consider this album to be perfection, from the opening of the first song to the end of the last. Flawless, in my opinion. Let It Bleed also proved that the Stones' Beggar Banquets was not a one-off great album. They were determined to carry their brilliance going forward and did not want to stop at all. Although the year was 1969 and considered the end of the 60s era, folks say it was the end in a bad way. Terrible things that happened with the Stones. I say no way. It was just a bridge of just some raw and great rock and roll that went right into the 70s. Gimme Shelter and Jumpin' Jack Flash that set the tone. This was all happening during a time in the world around the end of 68 and 69. There was festivals, concerts, fashion, assassinations, politics, riots, protests, technology, war, gangs, disease. The Stones had all of this happening at once, and they were feeding off of it. And then you include their micro world of drug busts and the drama internally. There was plenty of it. It is all about how you feel then and what you think about. That is why the Stones are not repetitive. They take what's given to them right at the time. All of this was fuel for their creativity. It was known that the pop culture, especially musicians, were marked people. The Police related these pop stars to drugs, a moral threat to youth society. The Police figured if you stop these icons, these pop stars, worshipped by fans, then you stop the drugs and the spreading of it. This is why we saw and heard about so many drug busts and arrests due to the planting of drugs in their homes and possessions. It was a priority, it was a determination of the Police to stop it. But then again, there was some carelessness still going on. It was also at this time when Keith and Anita drifted into heroin, the highest quality. Keith said, within this special time of Beggar's Banquet and Let It Bleed, the drugs did not dictate the greatness of creativity. It may have altered it, a few chord changes here and there or verses, but no extra lift or aid. It did push him to be more tenacious and develop deep concentration to complete something more than normal and not to quit. Now let's just jump back a little bit to 1967, 68, and Keith, during the downtime after Santanic's Majesties, he started learning and expanding his guitar techniques and go into open tuning. He had to get advanced and make a change. Open tuning was Keith's new choice for guitar chords. And as a fan, he knew Don Everly, a great rhythm player, used this for Wake Up Little Susie and Bye Bye Love. And Keith adapted the D and E open tuning. He's got to thank the great Taj Mahal for teaching him about this. Open tuning is basically when you tune a guitar string to a certain note and you play all those notes together without any fingers on the fretboard. It'll play that chord. And this was the advancement to get to Keith's sound. Now let's jump back to 1968 Beggar's Banquet sessions, starting around February and going through July. I had to mention the open tuning, but Keith's reawakening and time to get out of his stagnant box was just increasingly in his mind. And again, it allowed the Stones to cross over to a side of a new wilderness and to learn and explore and create. In comes Graham Parsons, 21-year-old-ish, leading the Byrds now to a new dimension. They were on their way touring in England and on their way to South Africa to a tour. In the book Life, Keith's biography, he went to see them one night in 1968. He was really expecting them to play Hey Mr. Tambourine Man and those hits. Little did he know he was blown away with a country twang, Sweethearts of the Rodeo, Keith met Graham backstage that night. The first thing Graham asked was, "Hey man, got anything?" They clicked right there. Keith told Graham about apartheid in South Africa, and no one goes there, not to play. Graham quit the Birds that night. They stayed up and played and talked five nights straight. Keith excelling in open tuning and country. He was learning the difference between Bakersfield and Nashville country styles. Graham would play it on piano and taught Keith. And that's how Keith started writing songs. He picked it up there. And he started expanding. In my Goat's Head Soup documentary, I brought to light the name of Jimmy Miller and his contributions and brought the Stones to a level that probably they may not have gotten. He was a catalyst also and a big contributor. But I need to mention another name. That is Jack Nietzsche. You've seen his name before, but many do not know how he's tied into the Stones and the music world. He started with composing and writing songs and becoming well known in the time of the early 60s. He was a top, superb music arranger. What is an arranger? Well, they will envision and imagine the direction of an existing composition and the way it should go and take the correct instruments and apply it, the voices, the rhythms, the tempo, to create a new sound. Jack jumped levels as he became the go-to person for Phil Spector in 61, also working with Sonny Bono. He also wrote hits for other people, and he met the Stones in October 1964 at the Santa Monica Civic Auditorium. It was during a filming of a show. He saw them as future leaders of music changing. Jack immediately introduced the Stones to the RCA Hollywood Studios' top recording engineer, David Hassinger. They all clicked. They all worked on six songs November 2nd, 64 for their second album. Jack worked on the creativity of the top song, Satisfaction, Paint It Black, Let's Spend the Night Together, out of the box songs, genius level work. Keith recognized Jack as a beautiful freak and American Brian Jones. He was the architect of the Stones' 60s sounds. He was more of a guide than an advisor. Jack Nietzsche also played piano and organ for the Stones. Jack went on to do some movie scores and was real successful. His compilation and contributions are phenomenal, with numerous movies and known ones, and doing a great job. You'll be amazed at this list. Jack passed in 2000 at 63 years old of a heart attack. Now, the Stones were finishing up in the studio. They were working on that new blues album, the new driven blues album, Beggar's Banquet. But there was a lot of complications going on, a lot of issues. Brian being one of them. He was ordered by a judge to go on trial again in September. More drug-related issues. This was real critical. The Stones could not tour now with Brian's absence. They couldn't promote Beggar's Banquet. While in the studio, the Stones were recording the Sympathy for the Devil documentary and the song, and one of the lights caught fire. Fire trucks came in and soaked the entire studio and equipment. In June, Jack Nietzsche had invited a 21-year-old Rye Cooter to London, invited him to Keith's Redlands home to accompany them for rehearsals. He wanted him to get a feel for what they were about, and he wanted to understand them and their thinking as he was going to be using them for future session. Ryland Cooter, born and raised in Santa Monica, California, playing the guitar since 3 years old. At 17 years old, he was playing in 1966 in LA with a great band that included Henry Fredericks, aka Taj Mahal, from Cambridge, Massachusetts. The band was the Rising Suns. They released one single. They were rivals to the Byrds in LA. But the issue they had, they were having a lot of bickering problems within the band themselves, between management and the label, and an album was never released until 1992. This album is a must-have. Rye went on to Captain Beefheart, and he did studio session work. The jamming with Rye floored the Stones, all of them. Rye knew how to groove the blues. In the 1920s, the five-string banjo was the go-to instrument in bands. The Sears guitar was popular and cheap. That is one the black musicians used. What they would do is remove the lower E string and then tune them like the banjos. This technique started to fade away though as time went on. As I mentioned, Keith played guitar in Beggar's Banquet mostly in the open D and E tuning. He did know of the open G, but not the way Rye knew it. Rye brought Keith to another level again. In July, Brian had flown back to Morocco. He went with his girlfriend Suki Portier. He was trying to expand the Stones from his perspective. He was working on recording the magical sounds of the master musicians of Djajouka. That was 70 miles south of Tangiers. Brian had said this is what he wanted to do and hear for the rest of his life. Brian had asked assistant engineer George Chikayans to come down and help him record. George did. He was working with the Stones, and he did also with Let It Bleed. Now, I tell you this because George tells a story while he was down there. Just before leaving to London, Brian and Suki and George went to a famous beach at Cap Spartel in the Atlantic. Now, the lifeguard had warned them not to swim at all due to the terrible current as being real strong. He said, if you guys go out, we're going to find you next week 10 miles down. Well, they went to lie down. George eventually just took a nap. He woke up about 20 minutes later. He saw Brian swimming in the water. He was about a quarter mile out. He was expertly fighting the current and eventually walking into shore. And he was walking in the same place he entered. He saw this by the footprints. George could not believe Brian's swimming and the strength. Mick Jagger had also talked about Brian's excellent swimming when he was swimming in some of the dangerous waters of Australia. Now, this is told because you got to keep in mind how Brian died. Mick and Keith were in L.A., and at this July time frame, they were mixing the Beggar Sessions with Jimmy Miller. The album was first mixed once in London, but they were not satisfied, so they needed their regular engineer, the 26-year-old Glyn Johns, to redo it. Glenn was working on Steve Miller's band's second album at the same time. While the Stones were doing some mixing in L.A., they went out one evening to see Taj Mahal play. Now, we know both have plenty in common with the blues, and Keith definitely knew Taj Mahal from prior, as I mentioned. And they invited Taj to come out to London at the end of the year to play at a circus-like event they were going to have. Mick had written and worked with Marianne on a song that Mick was going to help produce for Marianne. This song was called Sister Morphine. Rye was called in to play slide with this rough version, along with Mick and also Jack Nitzsche playing piano. We do know that the version of this album was eventually recorded from the Let It Bleed sessions in March 69. And that was also during a time that Mick, Jack were doing the performance soundtrack for the movie. Talk about that in a little bit. Now I want to mention something very important, I think a pivotal action that Keith had done in 1968. And he wanted to get back to basics of the blues and rock and roll. And he wanted to leave that fake psychedelic period they were not true to. And that was pretty obvious. Keith wound up opening up his vinyl collection and began listening to his influences again. And this led to their new era. Beggar's Banquet original release was July 26, but that did not occur. Both London's Decca and US London Records refused to release the album due to the cover design. We know the cover design of that bathroom shot with a toilet and graffiti written all over. The shot was taken at a LA Hollywood car dealer, handwritten by Mick and Keith. Executive heads had said that retailers and distributors would say that this is in bad taste and offensive. This battle from both sides lasted about 4 months. The Stones knew they needed this album for the December holidays. The movie performance. It was written and directed by Donald Camwell. Basically, a parallel to the real-life craze that lived in London in the 60s, about a violent London gangster that kills a longtime friend, goes into seclusion of a reclusive, iconic rock star played by Mick. Now, Donald got Mick thanks to his past girlfriend, Anita Pallenberg. They had dated prior to Brian. Anita got a supporting role as one of two Mick's live-in partners in the movie. Now, Keith and Anita rented an apartment close to the shooting of the movie. It was owned by Robert Fraser. He was a dealer and a druggy friend known to many. Now, like I said, it was near the shooting location, but Keith would never visit the set, especially due to the knowing of Donald's destructive personality. Donald had this thing for threesomes. Hence, Mick playing the retired character named Turner, living with Anita's character, and also the live-in partner called, played by Michelle Breton. They lived in Notting Hill. Michelle, the other partner, would need to actually take Valium shots prior to her scenes. Now, Keith mentions in his book, Life, he smelled it. He knew about Mick and Anita. Donald had explicit sexual scenes between the two. Mick and Anita's fling connection was there. They did it pretty immediately on the set and in front of the camera. Keith called it Peyton Place. With all this drama he felt with Mick's choice and taking over Anita for that time put a gap between them. Keith took on his fling with Mick's Marianne, both of them knowing the situation between Mick and Anita. They willingly and jointly and happily got together to enjoy their affair. Now one night, Mick surprisingly came back home and Marianne was there with Keith in the bedroom. They were pretty active and in deep. Hearing Mick come in, Keith bolted out the back window. If you can imagine Keith grabbing his clothes, half naked, jumping out the window. Marianne, till this day, jokes with Keith. Keith, I still can't find your socks. Now, Mick had committed to provide some musical soundtrack material to performance. He was reluctant to work with Keith on it. He was kind of hesitant also to do this, but Jack Nitzsche was pushing him also, and Camel. Keith was angry to the retaliation. He refused to go with it, and what wound up happening was Mick wrote with Donald the one song called Memo from Turner. When the Stones went to record it, Keith sort of sabotaged it. It sounded awful, lifeless. So the song had to be completed with using Ry Cooter and some other studio musicians. Now Jack Nitzsche was again brought in by Mick to help get this album moving and out. A few points I wanted to make about this album. It does feature the backup singer to Ray Charles, a woman named Mary Clayton, who'll be mentioned later. Also, Anita's character was to be originally played by Mia Farrow. Mia Farrow supposedly broke her ankle and couldn't be part of the movie. Anita, she did a lot of ad-libbing in her dialogue. And Camel had rating issues for the film. A lot of sex and extreme violence. He edited the 30 minutes of footage. But what he also did was he submitted it to an Amsterdam porno festival, not known to Mick and Anita. Now, Keith stayed focused. He would play, take his drugs, and would want to work on the next album's material. He was devoted and dedicated to the Stones, but pretty depressed. And he was buried with his cocaine and heroin, also known as speedballs. It's now the end of September 1968. Brian had a court appearance, but he was supported there with Mick and Keith. Brian was found guilty. Now, jail time, that would be catastrophic. His psychiatrist testified, and he left there with only a 50-pound fine and a scolding. It was around this time when the Stones made a purchase of a two-floor warehouse at 47 Bermondsey Street in East London. They used this for storage, rehearsing, and some recordings. Now, when they weren't using it, they did rent it. They rented it to bands like Fat Mattress, Spencer Davis Group, and the Small Faces. Ian Stewart was in charge of this warehouse. Now, Ian McLagan, pianist for the Faces, Small Faces, well-known with the Stones, he tells a story that when Ian Stewart brought him into the office to listen to a new album by Delaney and Bonnie called Accept No Substitute. Keeping in mind, Ian, both Ians, are pianists. And they didn't recognize most of the musicians on this album, Accept No Substitute. It was Bobby Whitlock, Great Bobby, Jim Keltner, Bobby Keys, Jim Price.
But the pianists were in awe of Leon Russell's piano playing and how fantastic it was on the song Ghetto. Ian told Ian McLagan how he played this song only once to Nicky Hopkins, the primary Stones piano player. Nicky walked to a piano and played the exact song perfectly after hearing it once. Nicky was the perfect piano player. It's imperative to mention Nicky Hopkins when discussing many Stones albums. In fact, when the topic of rock and roll is ever mentioned, he was studying at the Royal Academy of Music in London at the age of 16. He switched from classical to some 50s bopping of rock and roll pioneers. He joined Screaming Lord Sutch. He then went blues with Cyril Davies in a new band called the All Stars. Nicky just grew at every gig he played. However, he had major health issues and surgery that sidelined him 19 months. And this is 1964 time frame. That's when he was ready to return. Cyril had passed. To ease strain, he stayed with studio work. He played with The Who, My Generation, The Kinks, Controversy, Pretty Things, Bowie, Beatles, Jeff Beck Group. It was the quick end of the Jeff Beck tour that landed him in Rock and Roll Circus. However, he played back in 66 with the Stones on the Between the Buttons sessions. Cool, Calm, and Collected, his first, and Satanic Majesties. The rest is rock and roll history. He did not tour much due to his health. He wanted to remain in the studio. He had a botched surgery in 1992 that later impacted his death, September 94, at the age of 50. His life till end was filled with so many rock and rollers and his contributions that made everyone excel. At this time, the Stones were rehearsing and playing at the warehouse until mid-November. Charlie was also producing and working on a free jazz project with a group called The People Band. This was at the Olympic Studios. Brian had requested for the use of the warehouse space also, being it had an Ampex 8-track recorder installed. He wanted to devote time into the side project of Jujuka. This was to occupy Brian's time. With the satisfaction from the Stones as they stepped into their next recording phase for the new album. Now, Marianne and Mick had issues during this time. Marianne was still legally married to John Dunbar and could not marry Mick. But what was worse, Marianne had a miscarriage with Mick. At this time, she was very depressed and she turned to heavy drugs. Mick added lyrics to the Memo from Turner song, "The Baby's Dead, My Lady Said."